MedCram.com.
Okay, so based on everything that we know now, we're going to go ahead and show you how to interpret PFTs. The first thing you want to do is you want to look at the FVC, and you want to see whether or not it's greater than 80% of predicted. This is the first thing that I look at, and you really want to look at just any FVC. If any FVC is greater than 80% of predicted, the answer is yes, or if the answer is no. And this is the algorithm that we're going to look at here. If the FVC is greater than 80% of predicted, then what you can say here is that you have no restriction. No restriction. And that's our first diagnosis that we can come up with right off the bat. If, however, the FVC is less than 80% of predicted, or the answer is no, then we can say that we either have restriction or obstruction with air trapping. Okay, so it's one or the other, restriction or obstruction with air trapping. The next thing you do in either one of these cases is you move on. In this case, you're going to ask the question, is the FEV1 divided by the FVC greater than 0.7? And again, you're going to have a yes, and you're going to have a no. If the answer is yes, then there is no obstruction. So by definition, if the FEV1 divided by the FVC is greater than 0.7, there is no obstruction. If, however, it's less than that, then you have obstruction. Okay. The next thing, let's go back here. If the FVC is not greater than 80% of predicted, then you either have restriction or obstruction with air trapping. The next question that you ask in this situation is the total lung capacity greater than 80% predicted? If the answer is yes, then you have obstruction with air trapping. If the answer is no, in other words, if it's less than 80% of predicted, then you have, guess what, a restriction. Now, there's something you should know about in terms of obstruction and the severity. There's different, there used to be gold classifications in terms of Roman numerals. They've now used severity and also symptomatology, but if they're ever talking to you about the gold stages, there's gold stage 1, stage 2, stage 3, and stage 4. And for that, we look at the FEV1 only, the FEV1 percent predicted. 1 is 80 to 100, 2 is 50 to 80. 3 is 30 to 50, and 4 is 0 to 30. It's also, you go right to stage 4 if there is respiratory failure with an elevated PCO2 level. The other thing that you should know about when you have obstruction is you really should be able to classify if there is reactivity or not. And the ATS criteria for reactivity is FEV1 or FVC change in post-bronchodilator in comparison to pre-bronchodilator of greater than 12% and 200 milliliters. If you don't have either of those two, or if you have neither of those two, then it is non-reactive. This doesn't tell you whether or not you should give bronchodilators. It is helpful, though, in telling you whether or not this has, if there is reactive airways disease. The other thing to look at is the DLCO. DLCO and whether or not it is greater than 80% of predicted. Okay, if the DLCO is greater than 80% of predicted, then you have normal membrane surface area. If it is less than 80% of predicted, then of course it's abnormal surface membrane or membrane surface area. Okay, however, the next thing to look at is the DLCO divided by the alveolar ventilation. And if it is greater than 80% of predicted. Now remember what we're looking at here. We're seeing whether or not the DLCO divided by the alveolar ventilation is still pretty good. This is an indication and distinguishing characteristic between extrinsic and intrinsic lung disease. Of course, for yes, it would be extrinsic, and for no, it would be intrinsic. So what are some examples? This would be like scoliosis or Guillain-Barré syndrome. And this would be, for instance, pulmonary fibrosis or, for instance, COPD. Okay, so let's go over this again. If you've got a forced vital capacity of greater than 80% of predicted, no restriction. You can say that right off the bat. Then you look at the FEV1 divided by the FEC. If it's greater than 0.7, then no obstruction. You're done. You've got no restriction. You've got no obstruction. If the FEV1 divided by the FVC is less than 0.7, however, then you've got obstruction, no restriction. Let's go back to the very beginning. If you don't have an FVC of greater than 80% of predicted, then you could have restriction or obstructive with air trapping. The way you tell the difference between the two is by looking at spirometry. If your total lung capacity is greater than 80% of predicted, then you know you don't have restriction going on, but it's more of an air trapping situation. And that's where the obstruction comes in. If your total lung capacity is less than 80% of predicted, then there's a good chance that it's restriction that's causing both the total lung capacity to be low and the FVC to be low. Once you've diagnosed obstruction, then you can break it down into different severity and say whether or not there's reactivity or no reactivity. In a separate situation, you've got the DLCO. If the DLCO is normal, that's great. If it's not, it could be because of extrinsic disease or intrinsic disease. By looking at the DLCO divided by the alveolar ventilation, you can make a distinguishing characteristic. Once you know if this is extrinsic disease or intrinsic disease, you can put it together with your other diagnoses up above, which are in double squares, and figure out which way your diagnosis goes. So keep this written down. We're going to go over some actual examples, and we'll be able to tell what the diagnosis is by interpreting the PFTs correctly.